Good evening class. Today we will be studying about the blood coagulation or blood clot. The blood coagulation, it is a process by which the fluid nature of blood is loosed and it forms a semi-solid jelly-like substance which is called a blood clot. So once again I will tell the definition. The blood clotting or blood coagulation, it is a process by which the fluid nature of the blood is loosed and it forms a jelly-like, semi-solid jelly-like substance. That is blood clotting or blood coagulation. Next, what is the importance of blood coagulation in our body? Blood coagulation or blood clotting plays a very important role. That is, in case of blood loss or in case of a small wound or any scar in our body, it helps to prevent the excess loss of blood. So actually the blood coagulation or blood clotting, it is not a simple process. It is a very complex process. It requires a cascading of events which takes place in our vascular system. So it is a very complex process. When we visualize using an electron microscope, you can see the structure as like this. Here you can see the blood clot has some of the RBC cells, some of the platelet cells, and also a white long thread-like substance which is the fibrin. So the formation of fibrin is a very important step for the blood coagulation. So actually, what is this fibrin? This fibrin molecule, it is a fibrous non-globular protein. Actually this fibrin is a protein which is non-globular and it is fibrous non-globular protein. And the formation of this fibrin is a mark for the blood coagulation. So we will be discussing in detail about how this fibrin polymer is formed, and you will be discussing about two main pathways, that is intrinsic and extrinsic pathways, and what are the different blood clotting factors. So we can get into the subject. The blood coagulation or a blood clotting, as I have already told you, that it is a very complex process and it occurs in a cascading event. The cascading event means a particular protein get activated inside the blood and it further initiates the activation of another protein or another blood clotting factor. And as a result, a chain of reaction takes place and at last the fibrin monomers are formed. And this fibrin monomer then get converted into fibrin polymers, which is what we have seen in the diagram, that is electron microscope diagram, that long chain of threads, that is the fibrin polymers. So you can see here some of the proteins. These are some of the proteins and elements which are very much essential for the blood coagulation. And these proteins are called blood clotting factors. Blood clotting factors. These are the 12 blood clotting factors. We will name it as clotting factor 1, 2, 3 and up till there are 1 to 5 and then 7 to 13. So altogether there are 12 blood clotting factors. So blood clotting factors are of 12 in numbers. Okay, altogether there are 12 blood clotting factors. Now we can see what are the different types of blood clotting factors. This is the first blood clotting factor, that is fibrinogen. This is the factor 1. Fibrinogen is the factor 1, and prothrombin. Prothrombin is factor 2. This is another blood clotting factor. And here you can see thromboplastin. Thromboplastin is factor 3, and calcium. These are all proteins. Okay, all these factors are blood clotting factors, are protein except factor 4. Factor 4 is calcium. So factor 4 is calcium, And next you can see proacelerin. This is the factor 5. Okay, factor 5. And here in the blood coagulation, there is no such factor called factor 6. This is convertin, which is factor 7. Okay, so fibrinogen, factor 1, then next factor 2, prothrombin, factor 3, thromboplastin, factor 4 is calcium, and factor 5 is proacelerin, and factor 7 is convertin. There is no factor called factor 6. Next is factor 8, which is a very important factor for the blood coagulation. Factor 8 is called antihemophilic factor, because in the absence of antihemophilic factor, that is factor 8, there won't be further blood clotting occurs in our tissues or in our body, because antihemophilic factor is very essential for this cascading event to happen. That we will be discussing it later on. First we will be discussing the blood clotting factors. Okay, so antihemophilic factor is factor 8, which is very much essential for the formation of blood clot. And here is factor 9, which is Christmas factor. So after factor 8, factor 9, which is the Christmas factor. Then factor 10 is Stewart factor. Stewart factor is factor 10. Next is factor 11. This is factor 11, that is PTA, plasma thromboplastin antecedent. Plasma thromboplastin antecedent. And here is factor 12, that is Hageman factor. And here is the last factor, that is fibrin stabilizing factor, which is factor 13. These are the different blood clotting factors, but altogether there are 12 blood clotting factors. Okay, there is no factor 6. So blood clotting factors are 1 to 5, then 7 to 13. So altogether there are 12 blood clotting factors. And here you can see fibrinogen. This fibrinogen is already present in the blood. Actually it is present in an inactive state, that is why we call it as fibrinogen. Okay, fibrinogen, it is present in our body, and but it is seen in an inactive state. This fibrinogen get converted to fibrin. Fibrinogen just convert to fibrin, and this fibrin formed is actually monomers. Okay, fibrinogen, that is factor 1, which is actually a blood clotting factor that is present in the blood but in an inactive state, but it have to be moved to an active state, and this occurs in the presence of some other clotting factors that we will be discussing in detail. Okay, so you have to remember that actually the fibrinogen is present in our body or in our blood but in an inactive state. All these factors get activated only in a cascading of events that we will be discussing in intrinsic and extrinsic pathway. So here you have to remember that fibrinogen, it is already present in our blood but it is in an inactive state, and it get converted to fibrin. Okay, active fibrin. Okay, so this is fibrinogen, which is factor 1, that is inactive, and when it get converted into active fibrin, we will write it as factor 1A, that is active. Okay, factor 1A, active. And the first formed fibrin is actually a monomer. This monomer is then converted to a polymer with the help of factor 13, which is fibrin stabilizing factor. So each of these blood coagulation factors have its own importance during this cascading system. So that's all. Thank you. During a blood clot, you have seen, many of you have seen, that is when there is a wound in our body, there forms the blood clot. And above this blood clotting region, you can see a straw colored liquid, or a light, very light yellow colored liquid that get oozed out from this blood clot. What is that actually is? That particular straw colored liquid is nothing but serum. Okay, serum. And what is this serum? And you have already studied that blood clot, it is nothing but it is the fibrin plus RBC cells along with some of the other formed elements such as platelets. Okay, and along with this blood clot or any wounded region, you can see a yellow colored or very light straw colored liquid, that is the serum. Okay, serum is plasma protein. This is a plasma protein. Serum is a plasma protein. Okay, so what is this plasma protein? You have already studied that the blood composition, that is blood is made up of mainly two components. That is, first one is formed elements. First one is formed element, and the second one is the solid substance. This is the solid substance. These are the solid substance which is present in our blood, that is formed elements. And the next is liquid substance, which is the plasma. Okay, so the blood is made up of two things, that is a solid substance and a liquid component. This solid component is formed elements, and these formed elements are of three types. What are they? The formed elements of blood is RBCs, WBC and platelet cells. RBC, WBC and platelets. And the plasma, it is the liquid component of the blood, mainly composed of water. What is the main composition of blood plasma? First one is water. And the second component of the plasma is plasma proteins. So we have reached here, plasma proteins. Plasma is made up of, the major component of plasma is water, and some of the plasma is comprised of plasma proteins. So plasma proteins. And there are different types of plasma proteins. Some of the plasma proteins are serum. Okay, so I think you have you are clear about this serum component. Actually, plasma, it is the liquid part of the blood, and it mainly comprises of water, that is the major composition, and it also comprises of plasma proteins. And there are mainly three different kinds of plasma proteins, which are serum albumin, serum globulin and fibrinogen. These are the different plasma proteins. Okay, that is, first one is serum albumin. Albumin. Next is serum globulin. And the third one is plasma protein. Plasma protein. Okay. Okay. So we have discussed here is during a wound condition, you can see yellow color, very light straw colored substance, that is nothing but it is serum. Okay, so serum is actually a plasma protein. And what is this plasma protein? That is, our blood is made up of mainly two components. First one is formed element, which is solid in nature, and the second one is a liquid component, which is the plasma. So plasma comprises of two components, that is major portion is of water. Plasma comprises major portion is water, and the second is plasma proteins. And there are mainly three different types of plasma protein. They are serum albumin, serum globulin and fibrinogen. Sorry, there is a mistake here. It is not plasma protein, here it is fibrinogen. Okay, fibrinogen. Okay, So plasma protein comprise of serum albumin, serum globulin and fibrinogen. Okay, so these are the serum proteins. That is what we will see during a blood coagulation, that you can see some liquid that is coming out of the blood clot. And actually this serum is devoid of any blood clotting factors. This serum does not contain any kind of blood clotting factors or any fibrinogen substance. There is no fibrinogen, there is no fibrin, there is no blood clotting factors in case of the serum. Okay, so that's all about the serum. And next we can study in detail about the intrinsic and extrinsic pathway of blood coagulation. During a blood coagulation, we require the presence of fibrin. So actually the fibrin is the main protein that helps to plug the surrounding blood vessels. So during the coagulation, blood coagulation, the fibrin is very much required. So for the formation of fibrin, there is two main pathways that is taking place in our blood. So one is the intrinsic pathway and the second one is extrinsic pathway. So actually these two pathways yields in the formation of fibrin, which is a fibrous non-globular protein which is very much essential for the blood to coagulate. So for the formation of fibrin, there is two main pathways. One is intrinsic and the second one is extrinsic pathway. So what is actually intrinsic and extrinsic pathway? The intrinsic pathway occurs in case of during an internal trauma. Okay, so intrinsic pathway occurs during internal trauma. So intrinsic pathway, it mainly occurs during an internal trauma. What is actually an internal trauma? It is an internal injury. Okay, so internal trauma means an internal injury. Okay, so external pathway initiate during an external trauma, that is if any wound or any scar that is occurring in our skin or epithelial tissues, what happens? The extrinsic pathway occurs. So the extrinsic pathway happens during an external trauma. External trauma. Okay, fine. So the fibrin formation is not a very smooth step. It is a very complex step and it requires a cascade of events to take place. So there are two main pathways, intrinsic and extrinsic pathway. Intrinsic pathway occurs when there is an internal trauma. Or internal trauma mainly defines that is any injury inside the blood tissues, blood vessels, or if there is an exposure of collagen, there starts the intrinsic pathway. So the extrinsic pathway occurs when there is an external trauma. If there is any injury in epithelial cells or in the skin, what happens? Extrinsic pathway starts. Okay, so this intrinsic pathway occurs when the when there is an exposure of cellular collagen. Okay, when cellular collagen is exposed, by the time intrinsic pathway starts. Okay, so the extrinsic pathway occurs when there is a presence of a tissue factor. Okay, tissue factor. Tissue factor. I will be telling in detail. I'm very sorry for the external disturbances. These tissue factors are of different types. I will be discussing it later. Okay, so extrinsic pathway, in order to initiate this pathway, there should be a tissue factor. Okay, so that's all about intrinsic and extrinsic pathways. Now we can discuss in detail about what are the factors that plays during the intrinsic and extrinsic pathways. So first we can discuss in detail about intrinsic pathway. So now we can discuss about the extrinsic pathway in detail. Okay, so I have already told you that extrinsic pathway requires the presence of a tissue factor. So the tissue factor can be some phospholipid, or it can be thromboplastin, which is actually produced during an injury by the injured tissue. Okay, so tissue factors are some of the substances that is produced by the injured tissues. So the tissue factors are of different types. That is, one tissue factor is thromboplastin. Okay, thromboplastin is also called factor 3. Okay, factor 3 is a tissue factor, which is the thromboplastin. So injured tissue mainly produces the tissue factors, and some of the tissue factors are phospholipid, that is tissue phospholipid, and the next one is thromboplastin. So we have already studied that factor 3 is called thromboplastin. So thromboplastin is a tissue factor 2. So this thromboplastin, or the factor 3, helps to activate another factor, that is another blood clotting factor, which is factor 7. So factor 7 is actually inactive in state, it gets into activated state, that is active factor 7. So this factor 7 along with the tissue phospholipid, okay, factor 7 along with the tissue phospholipid helps to activate another factor, that is another blood clotting factor, which is factor 10, that is Stewart factor. We have already discussed about all these tissue or blood clotting factors, that is factor 7, that is active factor 7 along with tissue phospholipid helps to activate factor 10, which is the Stewart factor, into its activated state, that is factor 10 activated state, that is A. This A represents its active state. So now the factor 10 is now active, and this factor 10 along with factor 5, okay, factor 5 is proacylerin. So factor 10 plus factor 5 along with some of the phospholipid, okay, tissue phospholipid. So now I have already said that factor 10 is active. Now in our blood, this activated factor 10 along with factor 5, which is proacylerin, plus tissue phospholipid, okay, these together we will call it as prothrombin activator complex. Okay, what is prothrombin? Prothrombin activator, activator complex, complex, clear? So what is this prothrombin activator complex? It is active factor 10 plus factor 5, okay, along with some of the tissue phospholipid, that is tissue phospholipid. Okay, these are the prothrombin activator, prothrombin activator, and this name itself suggests what will be its activity. Prothrombin activator complex activates the prothrombin. Okay, here you can see active factor 10 plus active factor 5, okay, factor 5 along with some of the phospholipid, tissue phospholipid, which is produced by the injured tissue. Okay, these together, and one more thing, calcium also, calcium, okay, plus calcium plus this, okay, these are the prothrombin activator complex. It helps to activate the inactive prothrombin into an active state, which is the thrombin. Okay, inactive prothrombin to an active state, which is thrombin. And this thrombin is the main blood clotting factor which helps to convert fibrinogen to the fibrin. Actually, the fibrinogen is already present in our blood in the form of plasma protein, but it is present in an inactive state. For the activation of fibrinogen to active fibrin, we require a factor 2, okay, that is prothrombin. Prothrombin is actually factor 2. Then prothrombin is converted to thrombin, which is factor 2A. Clear? Okay. So prothrombin, what is it? It is actually, I have already told you that prothrombin is factor 2, and it gets converted to active thrombin, that is factor 2A. Clear? And it is required for the conversion of inactive fibrinogen to active fibrin. And what is this fibrinogen? Fibrinogen is factor 1, isn't it? That is factor 1, activated factor 1. Okay, factor 1. And what is fibrin? Fibrin is 1A, active factor 1A, blood clotting factor 1A, that is fibrin. And now what happens here is fibrin is now active, which is actually a monomer. And we have seen the electron microscope diagram of blood clot, and by that time we have visualized that some of the threads can be seen, and these threads are fibrin polymers. Okay, and that time we have seen that the clotting is possible, or the hard clot is mainly caused in the presence of fibrin polymer. Here, look here, this fibrin now formed is a monomer. So for the formation of fibrin monomer to the polymer, there we require another factor, that is factor 13. Okay, factor 13. And what is this factor? What is actually the factor 13? Factor 13 is fibrin stabilizing factor. Fibrin stabilizing factor. Okay, that is factor 13. Factor 13, it helps to convert fibrin monomers to fibrin polymers. And here comes the hard clot, that is fibrin fibrin stabilizing factor, that is factor 13, helps to stabilize fibrin monomers and it gets converted to fibrin polymers. Fibrin polymers. Clear? And only in the presence of this factor 13 we will get the hard clot. Hard clot. Okay, so what is this hard clot? It is when there is a presence of fibrin polymer in the blood clot, we call it as a hard clot. And what is a soft clot? During the initial stages of blood coagulation, we will get fibrin, active fibrin, which is monomers. Okay, so fibrin monomers, the formation of only the fibrin monomers, we will call it as soft clot. Okay, this is hard clot, and this is here now formed this soft clot. Where shall I write? Soft clot. Soft clot is when there is presence of only fibrin monomers. Clear? So what is the difference between hard clot and this soft clot? During the soft clot, that is during the initial stages of blood coagulation or blood clotting, we can see some of the fibrinogen get activated to fibrin, which is monomers. And during the hard clot, these fibrin monomers these fibrin monomers further forms a long thread-like or mesh-like structure, that is fibrin polymers. It occurs only due to the presence of another blood clotting factor, which is factor 13. So this factor 13 is called fibrin stabilizing factor. Actually, it stabilizes the fibrin. Actually, the fibrin is a protein. Okay, it is a protein. It is a fibrous protein. It is a non-globular protein. And this 13 blood clotting factor 13 helps to stabilize the fibrin monomers to form fibrin polymers. So that's all about the extrinsic pathway. Or in order to initiate the extrinsic pathway, we require the tissue factor. Okay, injured tissue releases mainly two different tissue factors. That is, one is phospholipid, and that is tissue phospholipid, and another one is thromboplastin. Thromboplastin is factor 3. This thromboplastin helps to activate factor 7 to active factor 7, and along with factor 7, the phospholipid, tissue phospholipid, helps to form inactive factor 10, which is steward factor 2, active steward factor. Okay, and this factor 10 along with factor 5 plus calcium and some of the phospholipid, which is called the prothrombin activator. I have written it here, prothrombin activator complex. What will it do? The prothrombin activator is one of the major step, okay, which you can see in both the intrinsic and extrinsic pathway. Okay, I will tell in detail when I discuss in intrinsic pathway. This prothrombin activator complex can be seen in both the intrinsic and extrinsic pathway. So this prothrombin activator complex is factor 10 plus factor 5 along with some of the calcium. Calcium is factor 4, okay, and along with some of the tissue phospholipid, it helps to convert prothrombin into thrombin. The prothrombin is factor 2 and it gets converted to active factor 2, that is thrombin. And this thrombin helps to convert fibrinogen, it is actually factor 1, which is also a serum protein which is present in our blood. It converts fibrinogen to fibrin. Clear? And here, during this step, only the monomers are formed, fibrin monomers are formed. Up till this step, we will call it as soft clot. They forms only the soft clot, and the formation of hard clot occurs only due to the presence of another factor, that is factor 13, which is called fibrin stabilizing factor. This fibrin stabilizing factor helps to convert, or it stabilizes the fibrin monomers to form fibrin polymers, and here they forms the hard clot. Okay, so that's all about the extrinsic pathway. Next we will be discussing in detail about the intrinsic pathway. So this intrinsic pathway occurs only in the blood vessel, and it doesn't require any kind of tissue factor. Okay, it doesn't require any thromboplastin or any kind of tissue phospholipid. So intrinsic pathway, it occurs in the plasma and it doesn't require any kind of tissue factor. And the intrinsic pathway starts, or it initiates when there is an exposure of collagen. If there is any presence of collagen in the blood vessel, there starts the intrinsic pathway. Or else another condition is when there is an exposure of the endothelium of the blood vessel, intrinsic pathway occurs. So actually the intrinsic pathway is a very complex process compared to the extrinsic pathway, and it takes time to initiate. Okay, that means actually the process is somewhat slow and it is a complex process. But the extrinsic pathway is very faster and it is a simple process. Okay, so they require only some of the blood factors, but in case of the intrinsic pathway, we require some more number of blood clotting factors. So that's all about intrinsic pathway introduction. That is, intrinsic pathway occurs mainly in the plasma, and it does not require any kind of tissue factor, and it initiate during any exposure of collagen in the blood tissue, or else in case of any exposed endothelium, intrinsic pathway occurs at the time of an internal injury. Okay, the extrinsic pathway occurs during the time of an external injury. If there is any wound or scar in our skin or any of the epithelial tissues, there starts the extrinsic pathway. But here, during any internal trauma or internal injury, there starts the intrinsic pathway. So it is actually a slow process. Compared to the extrinsic pathway, it is a slow process, and actually it is a very complex process too. So the blood coagulation is normally a complex process. It requires a large number of blood clotting factors. Okay, so we can discuss in detail. So for the initiation of intrinsic pathway, there must have a surface contact. That is, surface contact can be any of the exposed endothelium or the collagen, the presence of collagen. These are the surface contact factors. So if there is a presence of collagen or endothelium, exposed endothelium, there initiates the intrinsic pathway. So if any surface contact with collagen or endothelium, there initiate the activation of a factor, that is factor 12. Okay, actually the factor 12 is in an inactive state. The surface contact helps to initiate the activation of factor 12 to active factor 12. And what happens here is factor 12 in turn helps to activate factor 11 to active factor 11. Okay, factor 11 to active factor 11. Okay, and what is actually factor 12? It is the Hageman factor. We have already discussed it. Hageman factor. So the different blood clotting factor, that is factor 12, is Hageman factor. This Hageman factor helps to activate factor 11. Next, factor 11 activates factor 9, and after that factor 9 along with factor 8, then plasma platelet factors along with calcium helps to activate factor 10, that is Stuart factor. This Stuart factor plus factor 5, calcium and phospholipids, it is called prothrombin activator complex. Okay, prothrombin activator complex, it activates prothrombin to thrombin, and this helps to activate fibrinogen to fibrin. So fibrin now here formed is a monomer, and this fibrin monomer should be converted to fibrin polymer in order to form the hard clot. So that's all about intrinsic pathway and extrinsic pathway. Thank you.